Hi folks, this is Glenn Guy from the Travel Photography Guru. Welcome to our little podcast episode. So here's an interview with Stuart Davidson from Scotland. Welcome along, Stuart.
Hello.
How are we going today?
Yeah, good. Just preparing for Christmas and been editing up the Creation Wars for the Arcanum today. That's been one of my main tasks. Seeing as I've been on holiday from real life work, it's been a daytime task for me, which makes a change.
Yeah, okay. Now what do you get up there for holidays? 4 weeks a year?
Yes, usually 3 to 4 depending on the role that you do, but yeah, about 4 weeks normally. I tend not to take it though, I'm a crazy person who works too much, but yeah.
Oh well, as long as you're saving it up, you know, because it's worth money at the very least, isn't it?
Yeah, sometimes, yeah, so it's all worthwhile.
Yeah, well, fantastic. Thanks for making yourself available today. So we're going to use this opportunity to talk to you about your journey through the Arcanum, something that you're now quite heavily involved with, because it's still relatively early days for the Arcanum. But we'll get to that in a moment. First of all, just to place us into context, could you give us an indication of how long you've been interested in photography, maybe spend a moment or two talking about the gear you've got, and possibly mention any new gear you have or that you're hoping to get from Santa.
Sure. So I when I was writing my Arcanum application, it made me actually think about how long I'd been interested in photography. And one of the things that occurred to me was that I think it's almost been since I was a really young child, and I remember being at my grandparents' house when I was younger, and my granddad always had little slides, the tiny little slides you could put in a little device to view them and stuff that he'd created. And I always remember being able to sit and look through like old family photos and things like that, and I found it really interesting. And I think that is probably the stage when I first got the bug, if you like, was way back then. And I, through my kind of younger years and teenage years, always had a camera around. For some reason, my parents just, you know, always had a camera around, or I took one away on school trips and things like that. But I wasn't particularly serious about it. And then when I was in my my mid-20s, my granddad died, and I inherited all of his photography stuff, and I realized that basically he was the photographer for the family. And I hadn't ever really been aware of him having a camera with him all the time when I was younger, but looking through all the old slides and pictures and things like that, it was really clear that he always had it around. So it occurred to me that that role in the family wasn't really taken anymore, and I thought, well, he'd left me a bit of money, and I'd been playing around with photography just for fun with an old Canon 400D, I think it was, and I thought, well, you know, I'll invest the money that he left me a little bit of money, in a camera of my own, a proper modern up-to-date camera, which at the time was an NEX7 from Sony, and I'd see what I could do with it. So I'd been playing about with photography for probably about 2 years by that point. And then I think it would probably be about a few years more now since then where I've been seriously trying to learn and understand photography and understand the camera properly and get the basics down and see, you know, what I could do with it. And so, yeah, that's my photography journey. It was, and I didn't really have a focus of any type. It was just I liked to take nice pictures, whether they were of people or landscapes or just my kids running about or anything like that. So, yeah, that's my background behind photography. For my job that I do, I have to do a lot of product photography. But really, that's that doesn't translate well into just about any other type of photography, I would say. You know, it's basically white background, product, make sure it's lit reasonably well and get the picture. And then because it's not product photography for print or anything like that, it's for web, you don't need to be too picky about, you know, the size of the image or anything like that. It's very much get an optimized image for the web and then take it from there. So so yeah, it was very much learn the basics and try and advance it myself, and thoroughly enjoyed it. Every time I have a camera around, I'm happy. So that's my photography journey. I'm currently using an A7. Sony, and I have a mix of the kit lens and some of the older Sony Alpha style lenses. So the one of the things that's always really thrown about with the new Sony systems is the lens choice isn't particularly great. I don't really see that as being an issue because they have the adapter that lets you use the Alpha glass on it. So you have, going back to even that, I've got an old Konica Minolta lens, which is God knows how many years old now, which is a 17-35 f/2.8, and it works perfectly on the adapter, so I get autofocus and all that through the lens. So you've got lenses going back from then right the way up to the latest lenses that Sony have released, and then of course third-party lenses. One of the lenses I have and use a lot is the 70-200 Sigma lens for alpha mount, and I use a 1.4 times converter on that as well, so it changes it to roughly 100-300 f/4 when it's got the converter on it. And you know, so the options are pretty wide for that side of things, and I get on pretty well. But when it's a nice compact, quick, easy to go lens, it's just the 28-70 kit lens for the Sony. And then when I want to do something a little bit more, I go for either the 17-35 or the 70-200, and then decide whether the converter is needed at the time for the 1.4 times converter. So that's my main kit. Because I've focused a lot more on landscape now, I don't tend to use flashes. I've got a couple of speed lights and things like that when I'm doing portrait shoots for family and friends and things that I take advantage of, and an umbrella kit and all that sort of stuff. But really, I'm not that much of a portrait person. It's very much sports, concerts, landscapes, primarily landscapes in the last 6 months because of the Arcanum, but I'm sure we'll get onto that.
Yeah, okay, that's great. And I have to ask a couple of things. Firstly, you mentioned your dad's little viewer for looking at slides. Sorry, your granddad's. It wasn't an Agfa device, was it? Do you remember?
I believe it was, yeah. So it was just a little... He had a couple of different things. He had a larger projector. He had a little pod thing that was just this about that size. Yeah. And you just you put the slide in, and it just like a magnifying glass on the front, almost just a sheet of glass that expanded the image. I had a light behind it and stuff like that. So
I had one too. Yeah. I'm wondering, do you remember if you just put in one slide at a time, or whether there was
that particular one was one slide at a time, and then they had another device that had the rack, and you put it in, and then it would go along one at a time. So I guess it depended on who you were showing it to. But when I was younger, I was always had the little device. It's in a cupboard up the stairs because I held on to all that stuff.
Great. Well, if it's the one I'm thinking of, it was an Agfascope 100, and the 200 was the one I had, which it just had the slot on the side of it where you would actually, I think it could hold up to about 20 slides, and then you had this little, just put my hand up here, you had this little device where you go shh, 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 to move it from, you know, one slide would drop down and you'd see it magnified and shh, shh, then the next one. If that's what I'm thinking of. And it's bizarre that, you know, you remember these things, but in my case, I started in retail, and you know, I can still remember the price to the dollar of a lot of the cameras I used to sell. It's funny, you know, like your first entry into the world of photography, you just remember those things. Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
But it was actually a really nice device. Agfa made some very nice things, and they were black with the orange. You know, orange was a colour that Agfa used to use as kind of their logo and their branding, and it, you know, it's really, really nicely designed. And some of their cameras were much the same back in the, you know, the cheaper cameras back in those days.
Yeah.
German brand, of course. So that's great. Now, with the lighting, you talked about your studio photography. So I appreciate what you're saying, that it's just stuff for the web, and you've probably got to do it quite quickly and all of that. But do you think you've learned an appreciation for contrast in particular by doing that? Because, you know, you light one side of an object, the other side photographs darker. But with photography, it's so different to the way our eye and brain perceive the world. Because, you know, I have a number of mantras, and one of them is that the brighter the light, the darker the shadows will photograph. So is that one thing that you've discovered by doing this, that you actually had to maybe reduce the light on one side, assuming there's one light in use, reduce the light on one side so that the shadows don't photograph too dark? You know, you kind of made those discoveries along the way?
Yeah, so just to give a little bit of background behind that side of things. So I run a website called hardwareheaven.com for my main job. That's where I earn a living. And that's a technology website, so news, reviews, all the things off computer components, sort of gaming peripherals, all those sorts of things. So kind of the fun, geeky stuff. I get to play with lots of toys as a job, which is always fun. And one of the things that I try to avoid as much as possible is shadows. The product shots are very much, at least for darker colored objects, white background, and focus very much on the product itself. And if it's a motherboard, you know, usually it's a black PCB nowadays that it's on, or a graphics card would be a large black heatsink cover on the graphics card, and all those sorts of things. So trying to have just the white background and then the focus on the product itself, because that's what's being shown off, that's what people want to see, and having it as big in the image as possible, so that if people want to open up the full res version and get a really good close look in at a particular part of the component, then they can do that. So that's the shadows is definitely, it's very much get as much light in the room as possible. So that's why the room that I'm often seen in these hangouts is, it's not white, but it's a light color, because it's obviously reflecting as much light around as possible. I have a cardboard backing that I can put up just around to bounce light off and things like that, that comes back down onto the product from all angles. And then I have the speed light on the camera, and then I have some ambient room light as well that are daylight bulbs, just to give that extra bit of power to the light and allow as much separation from the background as possible, but as few shadows as possible. So that's kind of the angle I take it. Where it gets a little bit more difficult sometimes is when you've got a box that's predominantly white, and you still want to have the white background. That's when it starts getting that a little bit more difficult. But that's the same as trying to do like the portrait shoots, where you've got a light haired model on a white background and you're trying to get that separation as well and stuff. So those sorts of things do translate a little bit as well. There's some similarities, but very much it's about almost blowing out the background and trying to keep the product in focus and well lit, and not blowing that out as well.
Okay, excellent. Now, have you considered doing a little sort of tutorial video, putting it into the Arcanum's Grand Library on how you go about this?
I have not, but I certainly could. It's I kind of don't see myself as an expert in it, which is why I probably haven't considered it. I just I do what needs done, and then I write about it, the actual product, and then I get it live, and then I've got another pile sitting of other things to choose from that I just have to keep on repeating the process over and over. Not that it sounds a bit monotonous, but it's different every day, because you know, one day I'm doing a graphics card, the next day I'm doing a mouse, the next day I'm doing an entire system. So it's different every day, which makes it, keeps it interesting.
Yeah. Now, you don't consider yourself an expert, so welcome to the world of YouTube. But you know what they say, an ex is a has-been and a spurt's a drip under pressure. So
yes, absolutely.
Not necessarily something to aspire to. Okay, so that's given us a great indication of where you come from with your photography, what sort of gear you've got. And Christmas, is there something you're hoping for?
No, there's always, I guess, a wish list of things that every photographer wants. I mean, I would quite happily get myself an A7S if I had the reason to buy it and could argue it through the household that it was a requirement. But, I don't think there's anything that I really need at the moment, because I've got all my main lenses covered. I've got the body, obviously. I still kept my NEX7 as a backup because it takes the same lens mount. I can use the same adapter, all that sort of stuff. I think it's just little things. Trey last night on the Creation More show was talking about a new strap that he has that was really interesting that I might try out. And I've been playing a little bit in my photography with trying to do panoramas of vertical shots, so a lot of them all stitched together rather than the normal landscape orientation. And obviously one of the things you have to deal with is turning the camera as that's happening, and then the distortion or the perspective changes as you do that. And there isn't a decent tilt shift lens for Sony that I'm aware of anyway that would suit my uses. So I'm thinking about different little gadgets and things that I might be able to work around that problem with. There's the rails that you can put video cameras on that attach to the top of tripods that slide along in a horizontal might be a way to fix that. So I might get that to have a little play with, just to see how it works out and have a little play. So yeah, nothing major that I'm planning on buying, because I'm quite happy with the kit I have just now. I really like the Sony system. It suits me well. So
that's great. I'm looking to get into it as well. I'm waiting for the A7 II, which we believe is coming. A7R II, I should say, the full frame. Yeah. If you're looking for an argument to try to be able to get an A7S, I guess you've got young kids who every year do those big school plays in dimly lit halls, you know, high ISO capabilities and the great video capabilities.
I will keep that in mind, and you know, the 4K recording and being able to disappear off into the wilderness late at night is just an added bonus.
Yeah, absolutely. So hopefully that may make a difference in convincing the Allied Commander. So why don't we talk briefly about your time in the Arcanum? When did you join, roughly?
I joined in July, so end of June, beginning of July. So I had put in my application pretty much when it was announced back in just over a year ago. I'd seen it, I think, on Stuck in Customs, or potentially Trey mentioned it in one of his shows or something like that. So I was aware of it from that side of things. And it sounded really interesting. I think pretty much anyone who has heard the concept or seen the video that was put together way back at the beginning was kind of found it an interesting idea, completely different to the other types of online learning that are going on or most popular around the world. And it was certainly something that appealed to me, because I've done courses here. So I, for example, to improve my portrait photography, I went and I found a local studio near here which was run by a guy, and he hires in a model, and you get a small group of you in, and he explains how to use all the studio lighting and how to use high key, low key, all those sorts of things. And I did what was called an introduction to portrait photography, and I found it really useful, but it's very restrictive, and you have to go at this day, at this time, you do this thing. And you know, that for me, because I'm always so busy with work and family life and things like that, it really didn't work very well. And so I was certainly looking for another way to learn. And just the whole concept of being able to dip in and out of challenges and levels and the Arcanum, and having a group of people who were always around, and everyone was able to just help each other out, that very much appealed me. Because what I always found when I went to the little workshops was that when you get in a group of photographers who are trying to learn, it's a very productive atmosphere. It's completely different to when you're with working photographers at a sports event or something like that, where it's not everyone hates everyone, but really everyone feels like they're up against everyone else, and no one really wants to talk to each other and things like that. It's two completely opposite things. And so I found that through the limited experience I had with learning in a group of photographers, that it was definitely something I wanted to try. And I'm a very online person. I really enjoy doing stuff online, and my job is based online and all that sort of stuff. So it seemed like the ideal thing for me. So I put in my application. I guess, like everyone, I probably hoped that I would be picked by a Trey Ratcliffe or someone like that to be the master that I was studying under. But I really wasn't too concerned about who the master was. I was more concerned about how they would mentor me and what their skills were and things like that. And so it was around about June time that I got an invite from Ollie Dale. And kind of, it was actually after I'd redone my application as well. So I did my original application back in the November, and then there was something mentioned somewhere that if you updated your application, you got extra like passion score, and the more complete it was, the better, and things like that. So I thought, okay, I'll go back on, and I updated for my latest kit and some newer images and things like that. And it was not long after I'd updated it that Ollie sent me the invite. So I did a little bit of checking around. I visited his site and found out what he did, and there was a few images that he had done that I liked. I thought that I would have done them in the same way had I now seen what he had done. So, Glenn seems to have gone. Let's see. Okay, I'm going to keep talking just now then while I see if Glenn pops back in. So, yeah, I had seen all these images and saw that he was a judge at the New Zealand Photography Association. And so it seemed like something that I could get a lot of benefit from what how he saw the world and the experience that he had. There's. Hello, you're back.
Yeah, now what happens? Do we... Oh, we're still broadcasting.
Yeah, from my end, it just said that you dropped out, and then so I finished off my answer for anyone who was listening, and then almost as I'd finished it, you popped back in. So I guess I should finish it for you as well, so that you know.
Yes, I think you were just about to mention your bank account details. That was
yes, where we absolutely. Yes, yeah. So I'll give you them later, but for just now, yeah. So I'd done a little kind of check on Ollie because I'd seen him on Trace Variety Hour. He had been on talking about Virtually Famous, which is the documentary that he put together about people who were famous online. And so I remembered him from that. And then so I thought, you know, he definitely mentors in the right way because he has the New Zealand Photography Awards judging side of things. And he's a very experienced photographer in all sorts of ways. So sports, corporate. He did some landscape stuff that had won awards at the Photography Awards and things like that. So it definitely seemed like something that would work for me. And I was hoping that he was quite a harsh critiquer in a way because I had put in my application that it was important to me. Part of the Arcanum experience was to force myself to go out and get more images and just take more photographs and have a reason to go out and do that. But part of it was that I wanted someone to be quite firm in their critique of my images and not to say, oh, that's a nice image or that's an okay image or whatever, but to actually get properly in there and tell me what I was doing wrong and not hold back because I thought I would learn more from a harder approach to critiquing than a softer approach. So I was hoping that because he would have read that and then still decided to invite me that that's the type of thing that I could expect when I was going through the Arcanum. So that's when I joined, when I applied, and yeah, that was it was one of the best decisions I've ever made.
Excellent. Now, I know that you've told me this, that like me, you're a bit of a night owl.
Yes.
And that may have worked well because Ollie is actually in roughly my end of the world. He's in New Zealand, I'm in Australia. So how does that work out when it comes to, you know, the odd hangout or just being online when Ollie's online? Is that working out okay?
Yeah, no, it works. Certainly in my case, it works pretty well. I used to do shift work for a bank years and years ago, and since then my sleep pattern has just been just awful. There was days back then that I never saw daylight because you'd go in when it was dark and you'd come out when it was dark, and then that throws everything off. So since then, I've had a really bad sleep pattern. I always work late for work and stuff as well. So I'm always, not always online, but often online. And one of the running jokes that the cohort always had about me back in the beginning was that it didn't really matter what time of day someone posted, I was probably going to be the first person to respond. So I think I'm quite unique in terms of being available online. And in the UK as well, we have really great internet. So I've always got my phone with me if I'm doing something or a decent broadband in the house. So yeah, I'm always around. But we try to work around the geographic location of the different cohort members as much as we can. So sometimes we'll have like a group hangout at a particular time that suits people, you know, Europe and America, or other times it might be people in Australia, and as many people try to attend as possible. But we've got a reasonable split in the cohort of North America, a few in Europe, and a few in Australia and places like that. So we just all dip in when we can. We had a hangout the other day that was predominantly Europe and America that was in it. And I think if it had been maybe a different day of the week or something, then some of the Australian people would have probably jumped in. But no, it's very relaxed in that way, that just people attend when they can. And then, you know, it's one of these things that it doesn't really matter what time you set it for. There's just going to be times that aren't convenient for some people. So, you know, everyone accepts that and gets on with their life. But I don't think we have too much trouble organizing critiques and hangouts and things like that. It works pretty well.
That's great. They're certainly the things that I considered when I was putting my cohort together too. Now, your role is a little bit special because as well as being an apprentice, and by the way, you're at, is it level 19 now?
Yes, I've just done my level 18 gallery. I split it over two trips to get the images that I needed, put the gallery together, did a little video when I was out there and put that all together as well. And then, yeah, level 19 now where I have to select five images and then go through the critique, and that should be something I pass, and then it becomes level 20 and kind of waiting there for that to all open up.
Yeah, the brave new world. So the way it works, folks, is that there's the initial sphere, foundation sphere, which is levels 1 to 10, and then what you pass through 10, and then you go to what's called sphere 1, which is levels 11 to 20, and so Stuart's near the end of that, and then you pass through level 20 into 21, which is a new sphere altogether, and potentially with a new master. So Stu's just saying that he's at that stage almost where once he puts through this last critique, this last assessment task, if you like, he'll then be able to move on to bigger and greater things. So you're really at the forefront, because there'd only be a handful of people, I'd imagine, at the moment who are in that situation. And yeah, it's going to be really interesting to see what unfolds in the new year.
Yeah, as far as I'm aware, there's roughly maybe 15 or so that have gotten that far. And there's a bunch of us not far behind them. And, of course, there's been some people that have been in the Arcanum for a few months more than I have, for example, who've been able to kind of get through that stage, not faster than me, not slower than me, but just, everyone's going along at a rate that I think takes them there. So they're just waiting for that to fill up and make it worthwhile opening up the next experience to people, I think, is the way to look at it. Because if you let, the first person that goes in start heading off, then they probably don't get the community involvement that you would want from it. You have to wait until you've got that kind of critical mass of people in there to make it worthwhile for everyone to go through the levels, I think, is the way that they're looking at it.
Yeah, that's right. And, of course, to get the right bunch of people together with similar interests that are going to be matched appropriately to the master and all that. So it's not just a matter of getting the basic numbers. It's as you say, it's about having that critical mass so that really there's opportunities for numerous level 21 experiences in different cohorts. Yeah. And, you've just got to find the one that's right for you, and your master has got to find the apprentices that are appropriate to them and their cohort. A lot of effort goes into that, and it might be worthwhile just talking for a moment then about the advantages of the profile that you fill in, which is really like the online application form. So what tips would you give newbies when it comes to filling out their profile and providing the information that helps a master identify them as being appropriate for their particular cohort?
I don't think that the images that people submit are necessarily the most important thing, and maybe that's something that you're better qualified to answer on, but I think from what I've just picked up through watching different shows and hangouts and things like that, a lot of what matters is what people say in their application, and someone who puts a lot of effort into the background story behind what they're doing and what they hope to achieve from the Arcanum and who they are, those things are probably more important to a master than the images, because the images that people have taken before the Arcanum are great, and it gives a feel for what the person is interested in. But the Arcanum itself is going to hopefully grow the photographer more than anything else. So it's nice to have a decent base set of images, but it's more important to say who you are and what you can bring and what you're looking for, because that allows the master to build a cohort of people who will work well together. And and not in the way that they're really horrible people or anything like that, but there's just certain personality types work well together. And so, you know, and often different personality types complement each other really well and allow people to grow and get different viewpoints on life. And that's a big part of the Arcanum, is the community of apprentices helping each other. And it's all great going through the critiques and having time with your mentor, but the actual involvement that you have with the community of apprentices within your group is so useful, and I've found it just amazing amount of different feedback from different people on just individual images. It can be so varied what people say, but all valid feedback, and that helps you to think about when you're next composing an image and how other people would see it and how that might improve what you see. So yeah, it's definitely worthwhile being as passionate as you can be and as open as you can be in your application, without obviously writing an entire book of stuff, because you don't want the master to get bored when they're reading it. But, you know, explain why you will benefit and what you can give to the Arcanum, I think, would be the things I would say. I don't know, what do you think about the images? How important did you find them when you were choosing your people?
It's a very, very interesting point, Stu. I do echo what you say. Absolutely. It's interesting, the visual component, because I would consider myself to be a visual person, so I certainly look at the images, and I think, always I look at them first. Now, that doesn't mean that all of the masters will look at images first, because you probably find that all of the masters are not visual people. Now, that might sound strange, and it might sound strange given that we're photographers, but, you know, people get into photography for all sorts of reasons, and some of them are drawn by just the technology and the geekiness of it. They're not necessarily visual people. Doesn't mean they're not great teachers, doesn't mean they don't completely have their head around everything, but, you know, we all interface in different ways, but I'm certainly visual, so for me the images are important. But I'm not looking at the images as to say, oh, this person's really, really good, therefore they're great for my cohort, or, gee, this person's images don't look great, I don't want them. Not at all. I'm actually trying to get people at all different levels of photography experience, photography expertise, and also different levels of creativity, because in some images you can see some, you know, really technically proficient images that maybe aren't all that interesting, and conversely you'll see images that look to be really creative but clearly have some technical issues. I'm interested in all of that stuff, because I think for me, particularly at the sphere or the foundation spheres, I actually think it's important to get that diversity in the apprentices I'm working with, because they'll then be able to help each other. Someone who's you know, really, really comfortable on the technical side and not on the creative side will benefit by looking at images that are coming from an opposite kind of person, if you like, and vice versa. So, you know, a lot of the teaching happens within the community through the images posted by individuals and the level of feedback, the quality of feedback they provide each other with. And, you know, some folks are providing more technical feedback, in which case, after a while, I encourage them to try to provide more creative feedback. And those that are able to provide creative emotive feedback, that's incredibly valuable to people.
Yeah.
And then after a while I'll say to those folks, okay, now see if you can provide more of a technical feedback. So I don't know, everyone's like a seesaw where we're stronger in one area than another, and I'm trying to bring balance to my cohort, but also balance to the individual, to make everyone sort of a well-rounded, creative individual. So, yeah, for me, the photos are important. I also look at the links that they provide, websites, Facebook, Google+, etc. And I've definitely got a big tip here, because, I'm aware that some masters really want to see how active people are in Google+. This is some masters. And if they find that someone's not overly active, well, they might just move on, because that's important to them. But it's not necessarily important to me. Again, I've tried to bring in people with a range of expertise and a range of experiences on the internet as well, because again they can help each other in various ways. What I would say though is there's, you know, if you're going to create a Google Plus profile, which is important, because you know we're working in that platform at the moment, it's not enough just to have, you know, your name and a terribly brief bio in Google Plus and zero posts. You want to start actually contributing to it. You want to start using the technology. I think that would be helpful, because sometimes you click on the profile and there's really nothing there. It's so people have done it just to sort of think they're ticking a box and meeting the criteria. Well, you want to go a bit beyond that and start to put some content in there, I would say. I think that would be helpful. And don't put too many links in. You know, again, link to things that are relevant and things that are relatively up to date, and make sure those links work. Make sure they go somewhere, because it's very frustrating when they don't. And I suspect a number of masters would just say, off the list. You know, it's a professional application. That's the way it should be considered. But I think you're dead right with the description, Ollie. Sorry, I'm all over the place. It's Christmas Eve. I haven't had enough sleep for ages. Stu. I'm sorry about that. The description is critical. And you want to speak openly. You want to speak from the heart. And, you know, you don't have to blow your trumpet, but just by speaking openly, you'll tell the master what it is they need to know. And yeah, it's important. If a question's asked, for instance, what do you see as being, the ideal traits of a master, that's an essential question. And you need to take some time and provide a really honest answer, because that's a fundamental concern that a master would have in matching themselves to the applicant and also matching the applicant to other apprentices already in the community. So those questions are there for a reason, and you know, don't just answer them in a phrase. That's inappropriate, and it's not doing yourselves any favour. You want to make make a real effort to create a quality profile, and then come back to it, because it's organic, isn't it? You know, like you're happy with it, maybe 7 out of 10. Fine, come back a week later and bring it up to 7.5. And, yeah, you know, over a period of weeks, you'll get it up to maybe a 9 out of 10. And that could make a huge difference, because we have thousands of people in the queue. And if you want to get in, then it makes sense that you've got a really good profile.
Yeah, and make sure it's complete as well. So if they're filling all the fields, then it does tell you when it is complete. So just keep on going until all the fields are filled in. And one of the important things, if you're not a Google user, is the alternate email address, because I've heard a bunch of times now of masters inviting people and just never hearing back. And that might be because they put in their Google email address that they never check. And then if they checked it, they'd find an invite from a master. So put in your alternate email address as well, just so that there's as many ways for people to get in contact with you as possible if they select you.
Yeah, that's a very, very good point. And the invitation only lasts for 7 days as well. So that is the issue if someone's established a G-plus email address just for, you know, the sake of the application. And if they don't check it, you're right, because that invitation may be sitting there, and after 7 days it automatically disappears. So very, very good tip. Okay, well, that's fantastic. Now, how about we have a look at some of your photos, because that's what I'm really interested in doing.
Yeah, sure. I'll just screen share just now so you can let me know when you can see what I've shared.
Yes, I've got it. Oh, yes, there it is. Thank you very much.
Okay, cool. So I thought what I'd do is I'd kind of go through where I was pre-Arcanum and what a little bit of what I've done in the Arcanum and how things have changed before talking about the focus that I've got now, because the way that Ollie works things in his cohort is to have the kind of the first sphere is learning and getting to know each other and things like that. And when you move into sphere one, so levels 11 to 20, it's very much about finding a focus and concentrating on one aspect of photography. And that, because it's a general photography cohort that he's running, that's going to be different things for different people. Some people it'll be portraits, some people it'll be landscape, some people it could be anything really. So I was originally, as I think I said earlier on, just a little bit of everything. And so this is one of the images that I had taken, and I think that I used it on my application. If I didn't use it on my application, I used it very early on in one of the early levels when we were still allowed to provide old images to share with people. And this was one I took at one of the workshops. This was a natural light workshop, and so just learning how to work with natural light with a model and things like that. So this was an image I had taken wider, but found that this crop worked best. So, as I say, I was doing portrait stuff. This one here was one of the very first images that I took on my A7. So I think I had it delivered like 3 days before I took this image. I'd barely had time to take it out and learn to use it and stuff, but I was very keen to do so. So I took it along to the studio. It was a model day, so the model had been hired in to just work in two-hour slots with different photographers. I had the guy from the studio moving the lights around and coming up with ideas and helping me set up the ideas that I had in my head and take away that side of the having to worry about things and just being able to focus on the model and working with her to get the right poses and stuff. And then, of course, I was doing a little bit of concert photography in advance of this. And when I say I'm doing concert photography, it's very much something just for my own interest and just for fun. And it's essentially, if I can get access to a venue officially, then I try to, and I take advantage of that. But often I take my NEX7 in one pocket with a lens in another pocket, and then when I get in there, I just shove them together and I'm in the crowd. And obviously you get viewpoints like this one that work out quite well. And you know, often you'll have to queue for a long time to get near the front and stuff like that. But yeah, this was that's one of Bruce Springsteen where I'd taken my camera along. This next one is Richie Sambora from Bon Jovi with Oriente, who is someone from down in your neck of the woods, I believe. And again, just, you know, taking the camera along. And then the other way that I've tried to expand myself is doing a little bit of street photography, which is this one here was taken in Edinburgh. There's a festival that we have every August where it's theatre and arts and all those sorts of things, and you get street performers and things. And so I went out into that because street photography is always something I've wanted to be good at but never felt comfortable doing. And so going along to something like that where there's just so many people around and performers are always happy to get pictures of themselves taken and things like that, it's a much more open atmosphere for street photography. So I went along and captured this. Was one of the scenes that I captured, and I really quite like this image, and it was something that I saw evolving as I was walking up to it, where this guy on the right in the white shirt went up to the guy in the costume, and he kind of, I think he must have been from another country, the guy in the white shirt, because he, instead of speaking to the guy with the sword, he held up the kind of universal "can I take a picture of you" type pose in front of his face with his hands, and the guy with the sword just stared back at him, didn't break character, just stared at him, and that's why you see this pose here. But there's a whole load of other aspects that I really liked about it. Just they happen to be standing in a very similar way, and yeah, the guy on the left isn't wearing a white shirt, but it's a lighter colored shirt, just like the guy on the right, and they both have facial hair, and it's almost like a time travel device has been put in the middle of them, and you know, this is 400 years ago, and this is now, sort of thing. So it's something I really liked as I was going along. So it's probably the most successful street photography thing I've done.
Okay. Stu, now, it's not a critique, but would you mind if I just make one or two comments on a couple of the pictures?
Absolutely, feel free. Happy to hear anything from anyone about any of my images.
Well, could we go maybe back to the first image first of all?
Yeah, sure. There you go.
Yeah, thanks. So, you know, there's a lot of things I could say about all the images, but one thing that I think is really important is when you're photographing someone, so it's not a profile picture, it's like a three-quarter because, you know, we can see, if you like, the nose is dividing the face into two, but not 50-50. We've got like three quarters of the face exposed to the camera, and the other side of the nose, we're only seeing, if you like, a quarter of the face. So this is done really well, because when it's not done well is when the nose protrudes past the edge of the photograph. So, yes. Sorry, the edge of the face. So, you know, the distance side of the face, if the nose jutted out past that, it breaks the line of the face. And that's visually most unattractive. So the fact that the nose is being contained by the side of the face is really important. So that I think that's one of the reasons why it's such a good shot. And maybe we could just go back to that last photo you showed.
Yep, sure. There you go.
And of course, you know, just mentioning what I was talking about then, you know, if you hold a camera out in front of you, the way folks use a phone camera, it's very difficult to even see those sort of things. This is one of the great advantages of an optical viewfinder, when you can bring the camera up to your eye and surround your eye by darkness, you know. You actually then get to concentrate on what's inside the frame, and you start to see those details and can direct the subject in such a way to achieve a really desirable result. Now, yeah, this is great. And I have this concept that I'm always on about, which is called, you know, the concept of duality. And it really just means opposites. So we have some opposites in these images as far as, you know, a really neat, tidy, design-like clothing, and then a really ragged guy on the left. We've got a really neat, well-kept, well-groomed individual on the right, the opposite on the left. And yet what you mentioned is that there's also similarities. So I actually think this is a key component in a lot of successful pictures. The picture contains both the notion of duality, opposites or contrasts, but at the same time it contains similarities. And I think you often find people that make really good photographs, this is happening, and it's usually at an intuitive level. We don't really even know it's there until we examine the pictures or someone points it out. Another thing is that a lot of folks have triangles in their photos, or they have, you know, circles. They don't even know it until someone mentions it. And then they realize it, and you just start to see those images appearing more and more often. And viewers who, you know, maybe don't analyze pictures at that level, of course, don't notice those things. It doesn't matter. It works on them because there's a harmony in the style of which the style that underpins the photo, you know. So I think, the fact that we've got dualities and we've also got similarities is, to me, what makes this this interesting, and it's also what makes it humorous too.
Yeah, no, I think it appeals to me in so many ways. Just especially the humor aspect of it, it amuses me greatly. I smile every time I see it. Not and obviously that makes me happy because I took it. But I think it's one of my most successful images in getting what was in my head into a final image. It's definitely one that appeals to me.
And look at the negative space, because, you know, there's that almost identical space on the outside of each of the bodies, you know, on the edge of the frame. The guys are a similar size, but then there's that huge gulf in between them. And, you know, it's like space in music between notes. Mm-hmm. If you get one of those zany 80s guitars, you know, no one can hear the notes because there's too many. All you're hearing is a lot of notes, but you actually can't pick the pitch, the differences between the individual notes, and there's no melody as well. But, you know, the space, if you listen to someone like B.B. King, it's completely different. It's the space between the notes that actually bring out the difference in the notes and the different nuances in the music. So this large space in between them is a metaphor. It's kind of talking about the actual space between the individuals.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Completely agree.
So it's really, really important. So, you know, that's a great aspect of the composition in this picture. Well done.
Thanks. So the other thing that I do, just to blow off some photography steam, is sports stuff, because it's going out and doing landscape stuff, which is what I do predominantly now, is a very, you know, you take time to get to where you're going, take time to set up, to get the right thing, to wait on the right clouds or the right, just for, even for something like a hiker to pass by and get out of the image, or maybe you want to wait for something to come into the image. It's very much a lot of waiting. And I'm always been a kind of sporty person, very much interested. I watch whatever sports on the telly and stuff like that. And one of the things that I'm most passionate about is football. So as going through the Arcanum process, one of the things that has really helped me is just growing in confidence, and combined with actually getting things done. So getting a website set up and things like that. And so what I did was I set up a website, and I went out to some free sports, amateur sports, and got images from there and put the website together based on them to have a almost like a small portfolio to prove to people that within larger organizations that I could do what I was trying to do when I was emailing them saying, hey, can I have a photography pass? So this one here is actually the team that I support, and it's in a 50,000-seater stadium, and I just emailed them with my website and said, you know, I'm a student photographer. I don't intend to make any money from these images, but, you know, can I have this pass? And, you know, I'll give you full high-res images for free to do with as you please, but just, you know, give me access, take a chance. And they said yes. So I, with a couple of hours' notice, went along and did a full game at the football. This is one of the images that I was most pleased with. And there's a lot of aspects I like about it, especially how they almost look like dancers a lot. And I've noticed that myself, but a few other people have commented on it as well. And then I did, because I'd done that, I was able to go to one of the local professional rugby teams and say, you know, I've done this football stuff, so I can do that. Can I come along to your rugby game? And they said yes, so I did that. And then I went along to the new velodrome that we have here that we used for the Commonwealth Games and did the national track cycling stuff as well. So, you know, that side of the kind of the hobby side of photography is been something that I've been able to expand as well through being in the Arcanum. But probably the thing that's most appropriate is my kind of journey landscape-wise from pre-Arcanum to post-Arcanum, or not post-Arcanum, but now, post-Sphere 1, I guess it would be. So this is one of the images which I submitted for my original application way back when. And at the time, I was really pretty happy with it. And now I look at it and I'm like, oh my god, that's terrible. So over-processed, and I guess you could say that was a style that I was going for, but it's certainly not a style I have anymore.
Phase you're going through, maybe. Yeah.
Yeah, so
phase it's you're going through.
Learning more than anything else, I would say. You know, I mean, from a technical point of view, I'm kind of happy with this image because it was actually handheld. I was out just wandering about with my camera, and it's a three exposures merged in photomatics, and then probably played about with in Lightroom. It was so long ago that I have trouble remembering. But, you know, in terms of that side of things, being able to do it handheld and get it aligned properly and reasonably sharp, I'm happy with, but yeah, severely over-processed. But, you know, that's one of the things that helped me get into the Arcanum and to start along the journey that's got me into sporting events and improved my skills and got me open about doing things.
And so, I guess you're gonna get the sort of feedback that's more appropriate to the learning experience, you know, rather than just awesome. You know, you're going to get feedback that's more meaningful.
Yeah, absolutely. Anyone who probably in the quarter, I can't remember what we said about it. It'd be interesting to go back and see what people said about that sort of image. But, you know, one of the things I found throughout is that everyone will try their hardest to provide constructive feedback. And, you know, if the image just doesn't work, then some people are happy to say, you know, it doesn't work, it's not good, they don't like it. And not in a nasty way that like you would get on some social media sharing sites, but in a constructive way, as I say. So, you know, it's one of the things that makes it worthwhile sharing, even failures as well. I like to just throw a few failures in. If I'm out and I've got a gallery where I've got to put in 20 images for a particular level, a couple of them will often be things that didn't work out, just to show people, you know, this is what I was thinking, but it didn't work out. Because it doesn't help anyone to come in with your best, you know, 20 images and people to just be like, oh yeah, that's quite a good image, that's quite a good image. And, you know, it probably helps a little bit to show what you were thinking and things that didn't work out. And I think people gain from that. I gain from that because people might say, oh, you know, it didn't work out, but you could try this and try that, and or maybe crop differently even, and just things like that that make you think about things. You might just think, oh, I wasn't there at the right time of day, or it was the wrong weather, or anything like that. But actually, it might be even more than that, and you're just not thinking about it in the right way.
Yeah, and I think what happens is that you make photographs along the way so as to, and that includes on the desktop, so as to arrive at a destination. So, you know, it's not the tent photograph, the final photograph, could not have been made without the preceding nine. And again, that's also true for the way we process. We produce rubbish so as to get to a level of expertise and to produce an aesthetically pleasing result. It's only natural that when we get into a new technology like HDR that we overdo it. I think everyone does initially, mm-hmm. And we often need a bit of guidance to pull us back to something that it doesn't have to look realistic, but it just, as you say, it usually is best if it's not looking over-processed, because what that does is it just screams out computer. It screams out processing rather than talking about what's actually important in the image. You know, the images need to be about themselves, not about the way they were processed.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I still do for the landscapes HDR, but I try as much as possible to lean towards the natural side of HDR, just using the multiple exposures to get a better dynamic range rather than going heavy on the post-processing. And this image that I've got up just now with the phone box is me. This is the start of that journey. I think it's one of the early examples of that, where I'd gone from that, the image of the crane where it was really over the top, to still processing quite heavily on this image, but pulling back a little bit. And it's actually one of the first images that benefits a little bit from the critique element of the Arcanum, because I took it into a critique, and Ollie worked on the image a little bit within the critique. I actually took the file and changed it about a little bit and showed me how the bank on the right-hand side there, for example, was a lot darker in my original processing, and he just lightened it up a bit and said, you know, that's how I would do it, and I completely agreed that it was definitely an improvement. So I went off and I reprocessed it, and I brought up the exposure a little bit on the bank, not completely, but enough that it wasn't dragging your eye over, and it just allowed me to see it differently. I had a little bit more of a vignette on the image as well, and took that away and you know, played about with it a little bit, and took the feedback that I was getting from Ollie and improved the image. And I still like the composition, and I was reasonably happy with the processing, and the sign on the phone box always amuses me as well. I like the humor of that. But there was still a long way to go at this point, and you know, I was getting just little tips. And one of the things I've always been keen to get out of the Arcanum is to improve my post-processing. I had very little Lightroom and Photoshop knowledge coming into the Arcanum, and so I've watched a bunch of critiques and how-tos and all that sort of stuff. One of the reasons I got to where I am in the Heroes team is because I've watched just hundreds of videos, I guess, and was known for watching a lot of videos, which raised people's awareness of who I was and stuff like that. So yeah, I've learned a bunch about post processing, but still have a long way to go now. And you know, this next
Ollie, Stu, I just have to ask you a quick question there,
sure.
Because yeah, there's several components to the Arcanum. One of them is the grand library where apprentices can go into this huge vault, this huge set of resources, which are, you know, tutorial videos basically, some on picture making, some on the appreciation of the picture, some on processing, which a lot of people call post-processing. What is an example of one of those tutorial videos that you found really, really important just over recent times? Now, what's one that you'd just like to mention as an example to folks?
I can probably mention a couple. There can be some really basic things. For example, there's one that David Marks put up just in the last week or so, which was just him sitting with, I think, three images it was, just going through the tone curve within Lightroom and just explaining in a nice, simple, clear way, you know, this is what the tone curve is, this is how it changes your image, and this is what you can achieve going from like the just in a few quick steps. And it wasn't even actually a lot about the tone curve, because he broke it down even further into, okay, this is the tone curve, and if you move the curve, this is what happens. But he actually broke it down into the individual sliders within that sort of area, so contrast and things like that, and said, you know, this is what's actually happening behind what you're doing with the tone curve. And it explained a little bit about, you know, how you could improve the contrast of your image, and especially in black and white images as well, you know, just to get that extra oomph from your image. But I mean, there's things like that that are nice, quick, simple things, and I think it was like a 15-minute video, and it was really clear. And then you've got the critiques, and one that actually sticks out for me for one particular reason was one that you did with Hugh. He had an image from Sky, and you had said, you know, it was a really good image, but you said, you know, just flip it round. And then that completely changed how I look at images, actually. It was something that still sticks with me now. And in fact, if an image isn't working for me, I'll flip it just to see if it works different in the opposite thing. And it's the whole, you know, people from Australia and the UK and places like that read from left to right, and so your image, it would be good if it flows from left to right. And so yeah, it's something that always sticks out to me. Just the little things you pick up in critiques can be just as valuable as the things that you see in a very specific tutorial video. So yeah, I have to thank you for that one. That was a hugely useful piece of critique in that thing that was there. It definitely changed the way that I look at images and how I in my workflow, and having an extra trick to call upon when I'm actually processing things if they're not working for me.
That's great, Stu. Maybe I'll give you another quick little tip. Here's a French photographer from many, many years ago, and if I'm remembering, his name was Henri Latique. Latique, I think, is the pronunciation. Latique, I think.
Okay.
And, you know, Henri is in Henri. I'm pretty sure that's the right, the person I'm thinking of. And if he's still alive, he's probably in his 90s now. But, you know, he was a wonderful photographer. And one of the tricks he had was, and I'll tell you what, if it's not him, it's Cartier-Bresson, the other really famous French photographer. But one of them had this trick where to divorce themselves from the emotions that tied them into the photograph, you know, because it's very hard to be completely objective if you're the photographer, because you can remember being there, you can remember the day you'd had, the fact that you'd had to travel for hours to get there, maybe spend money to stay overnight, you know, all those emotions tied in with the picture, and you want it to work. But does it work? You know, it's hard to be completely objective about your own photography. So one of the tricks is turn the picture upside down. Now, this is just as far as composition's concerned, because what it does is it immediately removes your emotional connection with that picture, and you just start to see the way the photo has been designed, the individual elements, you know, the shapes, the lines, the textures, the tonality, the colors, etc. And then you can just say, well, you know, is it working? Now, this left to right thing is a very good point that you made. It's not really going to work then, because that's kind of flipped around, but certainly in relation to those other design or compositional elements I mentioned, it can be a really good way just to look at the composition and judge it on, you know, from that point of view. When you turn it back around again, that's when immediately you'll form that emotional connection again, based largely on memory.
Mm. Yeah. No, absolutely. I'll definitely keep that in mind and try it out next time something's not working. The image that I've got up just now was, again, it's another step along the road, and I'm still certainly learning even just some basic things at this point. For example, chromatic aberration and how to get rid of that, because there was some of it going along the top of the hill in the background there on the image that Ollie pointed out. And, you know, this was... I'm probably about level 8 in the Arcanum at this point, I think around there, because I'm sure I took this to my level 9 critique. And it was just, it was one of these things, I was on holiday, I could see that the sun was starting to set. I knew this particular area because I'd been there before, and I was like, you know, I think the sun's going to be going down in a really decent way there. I could see the pinks starting to come into the sky, and I was like, right, it's going to take me half an hour to get there. I just kind of grabbed everything, threw it in the car, drove in a way that probably wasn't very appropriate to get to the place on time. And in my head, I wanted the tide to be in at this place, but actually the way that it's turned out there with the tide being out, it works for me. I was disappointed when I got there, but you know, sometimes you work with what you've got and you see how it turns out. And I was really pleased with how the texture on the sand is here. And I mean, it's not that some people would say, oh, it's not the you know, the lovely sand that you see on really nice beaches and stuff, but I think that wouldn't have worked either with this image. The type of sand it is and the reflections and the pools and stuff like that really worked for me. But I was still very much going with post-processing filters and things like that, and presets that I'd downloaded from Trey and various other people to get my images looking in a particular way at this point. So, you know, it's kind of that halfway house, I think, in kind of the Arcanum journey, just still learning, still using a lot of other people's techniques and things like that, and ended up with this, which I'm happy with. I think it's a good image, not a great image, but it's one that I'm pleased with, but I'm certainly still a learning process. And then the images from this point on that I'm going to show are more, these are my Sphere 1 images, and the type of things I was taking to my level 14 critique. And it was landscape was what Ollie suggested for me for my focus. And initially I was uncomfortable with that, not because I wanted to focus on sport or portraits or things like that, but when he said to me, I think you should certainly try focusing on landscape, I was like, oh, that I felt kind of trapped by that idea almost. You know, landscape to me at that time was, it's just, here's a hill, here's a nice picture of a glen or something like that, and I just didn't know what to do with it. And I'd actually gone back to him and said, actually, can I maybe just do landscape and ruins? Because I thought that would give me a little bit more freedom to think. And it was a very close-minded thing that I had going on in my head. And what he came back to me, he came back to me and said to go and look at the landscape category for the New Zealand Photography Awards that he judges, or he's part of the judging panel on. And I went and looked at those landscape images, and it was in the same way that your tip that you gave Hugh about flipping the image, that it basically caused me to completely rethink what I had in my head. The landscape images that people were submitting were not what I would think of as a landscape image. It was sometimes it was like almost a street photography type image, or it was almost a sports image, and some guy or woman had gone up on a hill somewhere and photographed down into a valley, and there was race cars going around. It must be a rally or something like that, and that was submitted for the landscape category and things like that. I was like, I get it now. I get how I can focus or have this landscape being my main thing, but not feel trapped in just taking pictures of a mountain or a river or anything like that. And so it was another kind of reset in my head and another kind of path that I was starting to go down. And I think that there are still aspects that I need to work on, story within image, artistic vision. I don't think I'm quite where I need to be. I have stuff in my head that I'd like to get onto the sensor, but just haven't quite grasped that yet. But from a landscape point of view, I think I'm quite comfortable with that now. So this was one of the images that I was starting along that path with, and it's one of the things I like to do is get in the river. If I see a river, I'm quite keen to get in there and see how the image looks and get the camera quite low down on the tripod if I have to and things, because one of the things that I I'm aware of through looking at other people's photography is that lots of people can go to lots of the same places. And this particular area in Scotland is probably one of the most photographed of them all. But how many people would have gotten into the river and taken it from this angle? And just trying to think a little bit differently when I'm out there is one of the things I like to do. And so it's fun to paddle about in the water as well. You know, the little kid inside you. is always kicking about. So this was one that worked quite well for me, and I like how the water feels like it's coming at me fast in this one, and it's a little element that I quite like. And I played around a lot with the crop on this. I've got an alternate version which is much more kind of widescreen cinematic effect, where you lose some of the sky and lose a little bit of the water at the bottom, and that works in many ways just as well as this one. It loses a little bit of the impact of the water, I feel. So this was one of the images I started to feel comfortable with landscape.
It's very strong. It's not made in Glencoe, is it?
It is indeed, yes.
Interesting, because I have to just mention this. There's a great video. It was on DVD. So a TV show made, for Scottish television, and it featured a famous English photographer called Charlie Waite, W-A-I-T-E.
Okay.
And I happened to get a copy of the DVD a number of years ago. And I believe the show was actually directed, or maybe one of the producers was his daughter, Charlie's daughter. But anyway, it's pretty basic stuff, the TV show, because it's really there to excite amateurs about the landscape. But he's an experienced teacher, as workshop teacher, and he did make a couple really interesting points in the video. But I just remember him photographing with, I think it was Polaroid film, and then as the image is developing, this was an old trick we had years ago, as the image develops in front of you, you get a coin or a pen or something like that and start tracing around the lines of the buildings and the mountains, etc., as they're coming up. So you actually introduce physical texture into the photograph. And I just reckon, I don't know if that's the exact building, but I can remember him photographing, this is years ago since I've seen it, but photographing a cottage in a setting very similar to that, and I had the sense that a river was just behind him when he did the work. And I know he interviews quite a famous Glencoe-based photographer, and they go exploring, but there's also this image of a cottage in an environment just like this, and it's amazing how a memory from maybe 8 years ago just came back, and this photo did it. So thanks for that.
Yeah, it's potentially this cottage, and this is just on the almost at the very start of Glencoe. So Glencoe is off to the right, so not straight down that glen that you can see just in the right third of this image, but it's off to the right of my image. So it's right at the very beginning of that. I've got another image that I might try and just pull up right at the end of this that might be the very cottage that you're talking about, because it's very similar, but it's right up against the mountains. So we'll see if it brings back any memories for you. But interestingly, if it is that one, you're right, because I was standing in a river taking a picture of that cottage. So we'll see what happens when we get there. So this one here is, again, this is HDR, but it's trying to aim for that more natural approach to it, which I've been trying to expand and get through. And this is, again, a very similar area. So this is looking down towards Glencoe. Glencoe is the glen that's running off on the right-hand side here of the image, and again, I'm actually balanced on a rock in the middle of the river at this point. I've got the tripod on one rock, me standing on another one, and I liked the clouds. And interestingly, if you look at the clouds here in the sky and the general tone of the image here, and the one that we just looked at, that weather there is 5 minutes different to that weather.
Yeah,
it was one of those days where it was just, there were rainbows all over the place, and just 1 minute you were getting soaked, and the next you had blue sky, and it was all over the place, which is good, though. You can't complain about having mad weather when you're a landscape photographer. It sometimes really very much helps you, so you just need to be wrapped up well and be prepared for anything. So
One of my revelations over the years was that Ansel Adams' photography was not so much about the landscape as people would assume, because he was, a landscape photographer. His best photographs were actually of the weather. So to be in an environment like this with ever-changing weather, so many opportunities open up.
Yeah, and again, it was a more natural approach here, and it was just little things in the critique. Just, you know, I spent some time with Ollie talking about the clouds and how I had aimed for having them slightly. They're almost, or probably maybe some people would say they are blown out on the left-hand side, but I was just trying to emphasize that's where the sun was, and it was really bright over there. And I quite like in my images to have the clouds quite. Not blown out, but bright, and just have that little bit of extra range in them. And I know that probably won't appeal to some people, but I'm comfortable with that. I can cope with it, I think. But yeah, and there was even little things that you see, or when other people look at your images that you've spent ages staring at, and they just need a little bit of tweaking, like on the left-hand side of the image on the bank of the river there, that foam, the white foam over at the side, was much brighter when I'd originally processed it. And, you know, just little tips from Ollie looking at it and saying, you know, that really needs taken down because it's a real distraction being so bright, and things like that. And I didn't necessarily need to remove it, but I needed to tweak it just to stop it from being a distraction. So I was still very much even learning just some basic stuff at this point. And then my most recent trip is where, or one of my most recent trips is where this image is from, and this is actually from Sky. So what I decided to do for level 18 of Ollie's cohort was, the main purpose was get 15 to 20 images from which you could choose 5 for the level 19 critique. And so I've taken that sort of challenge as individual trips. So for the level 14 it was Glencoe, for level 19 it's going to be Sky, and I've combined them into little pockets like that so I can attack them in a very specific way. And so this was me starting to do stuff on Sky by this point. And this was the first trip, and I knew I couldn't get it all done in one day because I wasn't trying to stay over there or anything like that. It was just get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, get there for sunrise, get the sunrise done, and then drive about as much as possible, getting some key images that I'd looked up on Google Maps and things. I like to plan out the trip before I go and just get a rough idea of where I'm going, because I found that if I go somewhere where I think, oh, I've kind of got a plan, it doesn't work. It rarely ends up well. I did a trip around about autumn time where I went to the Cairngorms and Perth and places like that, and I was like, right, I know roughly if I get to this place and then just take it from there, it'll all work out. And I came back with one image that day, and it was just not a complete waste of time, but I really didn't prepare for it very well, so I had to do it again the next weekend and was much more prepared, and it was much more productive. So again, approaching it like that with Sky, I was doing the south half of the island one weekend and going back the next weekend and doing the north half the island, and I had key places that I wanted to hit. And this is one of the places they call the fairy pools, and you've got the mountain in the background there, and then the water comes off that mountain. There's about 3 or 4 peaks back there, and it comes down down the mountain, and then it starts turning into a river, obviously, as it comes down. And then you've got all these little pools, and the water is really, really blue. This is just fresh water coming off the mountain, but you can see the blues in the water there. And it's any water that's blue or green in Scotland gets called fairy pools or the fairy loch or anything like that. And I thought it was interesting to go and see it, and so I wandered up. But it was quite a hike to get up to this bit, but absolutely worthwhile. And I think if I went back, I would take a slightly different route to the composition of this one, maybe get up a bit higher and get more of the mountain in the background. But the weather was slightly against me that day. You can see the mountains almost obscured, and it wasn't working on that particular day to get the detail in the mountain in the background that I wanted. So I went with this image. I'm happy with it overall. I really like it. But I would certainly approach it differently if I went back to the same place. And it's also an image that resulted in my camera ending up in the water, which wasn't great. I hiked up one side of the river, crossed at the top, and then came back down the other side so I could see if the view of particular parts of this river was any better from one side or the other side, because it's definitely worth doing that. And as I was crossing at the bottom, I looked down and I remember thinking, you know, I bet my kids would really like some stones from the fairy river. And then suddenly I was lying in it. And my camera was too. So it was just one of these things. I'm not, still to this day, don't know exactly how I fell over in that river, but I did. So quickly grabbed my camera from the water, took the batteries out and then dried it off when I got back to the car with the towel that I had in there and stuff. And it's been fine. I left it off for a week and it was drying off, so it's fingers crossed it's not done any lasting damage. But worth it, I think, for the image. I was happy enough with the image that I didn't mind so much falling in the water at the bottom. And I've got, I think, two more left from this set, maybe even one. So this is one of the images I think I've been most happy with from kind of my time in the Arcanum. This is again on Sky, and I'd been around about this particular area for a little while. I stopped and had some lunch in the car and things like that, and I'd taken some images of these hills and they just weren't working for me, so I decided to wander off into the kind of the moorland or whatever you want to call it, and happened upon this particular set of rocks or small waterfall, I guess you could call it, and started to work with the with what I had there. And I spent a lot of time trying to get myself happy with the blues in the background, and I actually completely reprocessed the image at one point, and I posted both of them in the cohort and said, you know, here's the original one, which I showed to everyone as part of the level 18 gallery, and I went back later on and said, here's the reprocessed version, and I'd taken away all the blues in Lightroom, and the kind of unanimous decision was that the version with the blues was definitely had more of an impact than the one without, and I felt kind of the same, but it was having that ability to go to a bunch of people and say, you know, these are the options, and I'm swaying between the two of them. I know which one I like more than the other, but the one without the blues is probably more of the conventional image that I think a lot of people would aim for to begin with, but actually I'm happier with the blues. You know, what do you guys think? And getting the feedback from people about what they thought of the image, and so I'm happy that I've stuck with the versions with the blues in the end. I don't think it's normal, but they're natural. They were that color was there in the image. It's not a post-processing thing that's brought them out. It was just that's the way it was. It was a very stormy mountaintop, and it happened to come out blue because I guess the way that the light was coming through the clouds, and you can see the sun is actually right behind the clouds there, so it's just the way the light was working that day. So yeah, it was an interesting learning experience from that point of view, and an image I might not have ended up with had I not had the feedback from the cohort. So that's that image. So I'll just see. I'm not sure if I've got any more. Yep, that was the last one. So I shall stop sharing now. Yeah. So I think that's all the images for now. Well, if you've got anything to say about any of them, I'll try and track down the one of that cottage that I was just talking about, the one that might be the one from your program.
I think that'd be interesting if you don't mind, and maybe while you're talking, I could just ask you. While you're looking for that, I could just ask you, Stu, if you wanted to briefly talk about your role as moderator, and maybe your new role as hero. So in addition to being apprentice, you've taken on these other roles. Could you just kind of outline some of the things that are involved there?
Yeah, so in Ollie's cohort, I've been the first person to be moderator in there, and certainly someone else will take that over when I pass on to level 20, and I will still be in the cohort. That's a decision that Ollie's made, is that basically all the people that are in the cohort just now, even when they go up past level 20, will remain members of the cohort, and they'll get to see how everyone progresses, because one of the things that I was concerned about losing if I leveled up past 20 was, you know, the people and their journeys that I've been going through this with, because one of the things that I've absolutely loved seeing is how other people have evolved with their photography and how it's changed what they do and how they see the world and things like that. And I was concerned that I would lose that. So, you know, I won't, which is good, and hopefully that the same can be said of most of the cohorts within the Arcanum, because I think a lot of people will feel the same. But my role as moderator has generally been just to help Ollie stay on top of things, because it's very something I'm very aware of, that all you guys that are masters are hugely busy with 20 apprentices all wanting attention and feedback and hour-long critiques and just everything that comes along with the thing, and even just the other tasks that you have to do, the admin side of things. So I've been kind of keeping an eye on the two different... the way Ollie does it is he has the level 1 to 10 cohort and the 11 to 20 cohort, and you still have access to both when you're in the higher up one, but he's split it so that he can better have layout levels. And I think part of it is keeping some surprises for people for when they get up to the higher levels and letting them have something new to look at that point. But I keep an eye on what people are posting and answer any questions I can, do any admin side of things, or if someone's ready to level up and he hasn't noticed it, I'll let him know. And it just basically being an extra pair of eyes to keep things going in there.
That makes a lot of sense. Can I ask you, though, you mentioned help with the admin side. Are there some things there that are worth mentioning?
Just little things, like we do a weekend challenge every weekend where we have from Friday to Monday to create an image based on a theme. So sometimes I'll prod that along, but often when the vote happens and we all have a vote within the cohort on which image we think is best, that image then gets applied to the cohort's main image on the little thumbnail for the next week, and so I can go in and I can update that image and things like that. So just little tasks, nothing major, but yeah, mainly an extra set of eyes and ears and just, you know, whether I was a moderator or not, I don't think I would have treated the experience any differently. One of the key things about everything I've discovered about the Arcanum is the more that you put in, the more you'll get out. And it made a lot of sense for me to be a moderator because, as I said earlier on, I'm around all the time and always posting and sharing and trying to give feedback and stuff like that. So in terms of always being around, it made sense for me to be a moderator. But I think I would have treated the experience no different, and just been posting and doing all the same stuff anyway. And, you know, it's just having that almost like permission, I guess, is one way to put it. It's not the right way to put it, but just to go to Ollie and say, you know, you've missed this person, they need leveled up, or they've got a question, or anything like that, and just help him along. And then when he's away doing stuff, because he obviously is a full-time photographer as well, so he has times when he can't be around and doesn't see things, and, you know, I think it just helps him manage things more than anything else.
Okay, that makes perfect sense. Now, you know, masters come into the community from outside, and they go through a some sort of training process to prepare them and for them to understand the philosophy and the general structure of the cohort that they will then create. But then there are apprentices that go through a particular cohort, in the process of which you could argue they're being prepared to take on the role of master themselves. And that's actually a really important component of the Arcanum, and one that a lot of us masters pay a lot of attention to, because we are identifying people who we feel will make great masters because their personality as much as anything else, and their level of empathy and things like that. Now, would you say that your role as a moderator may help prepare you for the role of master down the track? I don't just mean you as an individual, but do you think the role of moderator would potentially help someone become a better master or become a master more easily and more quickly?
It certainly helps in the way that you get how a Google Plus group works and what happens behind the scenes, like changing the images and stuff. And it's not too complicated, and anyone could do it and probably pick it up really quickly. But I think just the extra things that expand out of that. So, for example, there's a community managers group and chat, and it's seeing that little bit extra beyond your cohort, I think, probably helps. And seeing how other people do things and having access to other community managers probably helps in anyone wanting to become a future master. But I think it goes back to what I said a little while ago about the more you put in, the more you'll get out. I think that doing more, just whether you're a community manager or not, within your cohort is the way to become a better master. For example, I just partially to keep myself sane when I was going out and doing the different journeys that I was doing for the different levels, I started doing little video diaries and sharing them. So, you know, it's just at the beginning of it, I sit in the car with my phone and just do a little video message just explaining where I'm going that day and things like that. When I get to where I'm going, I you know, talk about the settings and why I'm setting up a particular shot. And then what I can then do is I go back home and I edit that all together. And with the gallery that I put up for the cohort, I can then put the video up and they can see what I was thinking and see what the conditions were like and hear what was going on. And it's a much more interactive experience. And I think that sort of thing is probably more useful to becoming a master than being a community manager. I would say it's the putting more in and just getting more experience and sharing more with people, because one of the things that you need to do as a master, from what I see, is share as much of your experience as possible. And so I did it certainly to keep myself sane and interested, and if I had spare 5 minutes waiting on the weather to change or whatever, I would do a little video and things like that. But it certainly, there was a little aspect there as well of just understanding how to share better with people and what would interest people and improving the quality of, because some of the early videos I did, you know, I'm just holding my phone and I'm looking around, not on the camera, but I'm looking around trying to work out what I'm going to photograph next, and the camera's all over the place and stuff like that, and people will end up getting seasick. And now I've kind of, I take an extra tripod along with me and an extra camera and a proper microphone and stuff like that, and try to do it a little bit better. So that side of things has improved for me. But yeah, I think it's very much, if you are a person who's active within your cohort, that's the best way to prepare to be a master. You know, the skills and the experience are a big part of it, and it's certainly on my side of things, I certainly need to still work on skills producing better images and experience before I would even consider becoming a master. But you know, it's very much about sharing your experience and learning your own side of things that you can then pass on to other apprentices. Mm. That would be the way to become a better master.
I'd agree. I'll just add one other thing, a really simple example. The critique, being able to provide a critique to someone, you know, that's meaningful and helps them understand what they're about and helps give them practical advice to, you know, push them ahead in their own photography journey. A lot of folks would be uneasy with being placed in that situation to have to provide a critique. But where it starts is providing meaningful comments on your peers' photographs.
Yeah.
So, you know, all you've got to do is write a paragraph. Now, how do you write a paragraph? Well, you break it up to a couple, break it down to a couple of sentences, and you include in each sentence one or two words that are descriptive, that are emotive, etc., etc. You know, it's just one tiny bite at a time. But once you provide one piece of meaningful feedback, it's a lot easier then to provide a second piece of meaningful feedback to someone else. And before you know it, you know, it's just natural, and it's like sugar. You actually want to do it. And that prepares you dramatically for the ability to be able to just talk about people's photographs off the cuff without having to think too much. So I think, the more that's backing up, I hope, your comment that what you get out of it is really related to what you put in. It's in direct proportion, in fact. So the more comments you make on people's photos, meaningful comments, the more they'll want to comment on your photos in a meaningful way. So there's the law of reciprocity there. But in doing so, as well as building community and building great friends, you're actually learning how to be a master, because you're learning how to give critiques. So yeah. I think that's where it starts, within the community. Yeah.
You know, absolutely.
So it's not that hard, is it?
No, it's just, you know, just get in there and do it. And although, to be fair, there are some people who don't have the time for that. And I've noticed that in Ollie's cohort. There are some people that just want to work through at their own pace, and that's absolutely fine as well. They might still become masters some way down the line, but one of the great things about the Arcanum is just being able to do it at your own pace. And you know, I know that Trey and Curtis and Pete want people to go through the first couple of spheres really fast. But I think it's fine for people to just take it at their own pace. Some people's lives just don't allow that, and that's one of the things that the Arcanum lets them do. They can still have the online experience of a community. They can still learn from a mentor, but they also can build it around their lives. Whereas if you're going to an actual university course or something like that, that might just not work for them in their life with family and health and all those sorts of things.
Right. I think it's so what does really fast mean? What do you reckon would be, you know, for the first 20 levels, what do you reckon would be the average time the average apprentice would take to
get through? Currently it's probably 6 months, but I think people would like it to be 3 months.
I reckon three.
It depends on the master as well, because I think some masters build their spheres in a way that allows people to go through pretty quickly, whereas other masters have slightly more in-depth challenges for certain aspects. The key kind of points within the spheres are set out pretty well in stone, the critiques and things like that. But where masters have their own input into things, then I think that varies quite a lot in how fast people can go through the levels.
So, yeah, I would say people would want to get through in three, but I think the reality is that six, certainly from my experience in my cohort, six is appropriate. But, you know, I've had people in there who are working really diligently for probably 4 to 5 months, and they're now about level 11. So, you know, it may take longer than 6 months. So it's just interesting, isn't it? And we'll monitor this over time. But yeah, there's no reason to be in a hurry, because photography is a lifelong endeavor, and you know, you're not actually going to achieve that much by getting to level 20 in a month. It's just not going to happen. You know, the longer you spend, as long as you're working as consistently as you're able to, that's what matters. You know, and the quality of your critiques will be better because the quality of your work will get better if you spend that little bit more time on each one. Yeah, fantastic. Mm-hmm. Did you manage to find that other image?
Yes, I did. So I'll just share that just now. And you let me know when you can see it.
Yes, I can. That's beautiful.
Yeah, so that is this is right in the center of Glencoe. There, you know, you can't be much more central in the Glen than this. And I think potentially that white cottage over on the left-hand side there might be the one that you're thinking about. It's very similar to, but it's within the glen itself. So, and as you say, if it is this one, then you're right, because there is a river behind where it sounds like the photographer was standing. And I actually thought about a similar image to what he may have produced, because there's obviously a road runs up to this house and it goes across a bridge on the river, and I stood on the bridge, I stood on the road, I stood to the left-hand side of the bridge, and it wasn't until I was in the river over here on the right that I had a slightly different image to what I guess a lot of people, and when I was actually standing in the river here, I could see about four or five other photographers just in the half hour, 45 minutes that I was there, come along and take the exact same picture, one after the other, of this house with the mountains in the background. So I was getting a slightly different angle from this one, and I would revisit it. Probably I'll go after the winter sometime, because this place will be covered in snow now, and I know that because I drove through a blizzard a couple of weeks ago to get to Sky through this glen, and it was not a fun experience. So the snow will be there now, and when it melts, that waterfall that's coming off the mountain there will make up for a considerably different image, and obviously the melting snow and stuff as well will make for a different tone to the image. So yeah, I will revisit it and see if it works out any differently.
Wonderful.
Wonderful.
Now let me just power through the last couple of things. We talked at length about being a moderator. What about your role as a hero? What's the difference there?
So the heroes of the Arcanum are a group of six or seven of us now, who all have basically, we're putting as much time and effort into the experience as we can in various different ways. So you have Tanya Wallace, who is very much engaged with the community and does a bunch of stuff for the Grand Library. That's just a couple of her tasks. You have Tiff, who does all the social media stuff. So anyone who watches the Creation Wars will see Tiff on there, and she's doing all the Twitter side of things when that show's going on. But on a day-to-day basis is also sharing loads of stuff on social media and just keeping people in touch with what's going on in the Arcanum. I was specifically taken on to, because of the amount of videos I was watching in the Grand Library, and just having that knowledge of what was going on in there, what was being posted, what the videos were about. But my role has expanded almost immediately from being taken on as on that side of things to helping produce the newsletter. That's something else that Tiff helps with as well. We alternate issues, so we've got 2 weeks basically to put a weekly newsletter together each. We're doing an e-magazine now that I'm involved in, which works quite well for me because obviously having the website and writing background that I have, I can translate some of those skills into producing the e-magazine, and that again, you know, the hero role has helped me expand into helping out with the Creation Wars, the show that Trey does every week, so I edit that together and help with that. And then we have other people helping out with customer service side of things now on the Heroes team, with building the actual website side of things, with the learning experience, and we're all very flexible within the team that, you know, basically if a new task comes up, we decide who has the time or the skills to do it, and people just go off and do it, and if they need help, they'll come back and ask, and everyone will share tasks and things like that. So it's just about, we're all doing it on a volunteer basis, and it's just about trying to help provide as good an experience for apprentices and masters and applicants as possible, and keeping everyone involved in what's going on, and just being that extra team of people that, that help get stuff done, because, you know, Trey and Pete and Curtis have so much that they have to do on a daily basis that, you know, having us there to pass stuff on to is hopefully something that helps them out a lot. So that's what we do as heroes, and we get a nice little look into to kind of what's going on within the Arcanum as well, and get to give some input into upcoming changes and suggest things. But anyone can do that actually as well. And but even before I was a hero, I had sent a whole bunch of feedback to Pete through the feedback@thearcanum.com email address. You can, anyone can do that. And basically, when I got to level 9, I sent him an email just outlining how I'd found Sphere 1. So, you know, what were the good points? What are the things that I thought could be improved on? And what would I not like to see change as well? And just giving, you know, my thoughts on Sphere 1 to let them know how it was going, because, you know, one of the things that they value a lot is feedback from everyone who's in the Arcanum, and it doesn't matter if it's negative, positive, or just somewhere in between. They really care about hearing what people think, and so you don't need to be a hero to give them suggestions and stuff. And I would certainly say that anyone that wants to should send them feedback on the experience that they're having.
Fantastic. So, by the way, you're my hero, Stu. I thought I'd just sneak that one in. From the heart.
Thank you.
So, no, but I've really been incredibly impressed, you know, of what you do. A number of us masters, we have access to cohorts other than our own. We don't necessarily contribute to those other cohorts, but we go in and we have a look around and see how it functions and maybe what we can borrow from one cohort and bring into our own. I mean, that's a really great opportunity for us to build a better experience for our own folks that we're responsible for. And Ollie Dale, because his cohort, the one that you've been in, was existing longer than mine. He formed it before I started. I was able to go in and actually base some of the things I do, like that weekly challenge, on what he was doing inside his cohort. So, Ollie's been a bit of a mentor in that regard. He's a fantastic fellow too, isn't he?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And super intelligent. I every time I'm on a hangout with him or watch a critique or whatever, it's just like, that guy's so clever. I would never have thought of that, what he's just said. So, you know, it's nice but guy.
Let's very keep that our secret. We won't mention that to him. So thanks so much, Stu. It's been wonderful talking to you. I've wanted to link up for some time, and I really appreciate you giving your time so close to Christmas. I wonder if you could just tell the folks where they can find you online.
Yeah, so obviously if you search for Stuart Davidson on Google Plus, you'll find me through there. The main way to find me, though, would be stuartd.photography. That's S-T-U-A-R-T and then the letter D.photography. Hopefully some of you can see it over my shoulder there. But from there, there's a link on the left-hand side to my Google Plus, and I've got a new Facebook page that I've set up. But my main thing is Google Plus, and I have 500 pics. And it basically, like everyone does, something just about everywhere on all the different social media. But my main thing is Google Plus and my own website. So, yes, that is where you will find all my photography stuff.
Fantastic. And also hardwareheaven.com.
Yes, and that's where you'll find me during the day talking about technology and playing with new toys and telling people what I think of them.
Sounds fantastic. Well, folks, that was great fun. It was really good to see the images that Stuart Davidson's produced as part of his journey through the Arcanum thus far.
Yes.
Stuart's an apprentice under Ollie Dale and Ollie Dale's cohort. Stuart's a moderator in that cohort, and he's also a hero for the Arcanum, which is, he's really done a lot of work behind the scenes to help folks within his own cohort, but also beyond that in the greater Arcanum. And, you know, I know it's greatly appreciated, and we'll get to see and hear a lot more from Stu over coming months and years, I'm sure. Thanks so much for tuning in. Stu, I want to thank you one last time.
No, thanks very much for inviting me. It's been a lot of fun.
Fantastic. So, folks, we'll look forward to talking to you in our next interview. It's Glenn Guy, your travel photography guru, and hope to see you all again soon. Thanks, and bye for now.
Bye.